Hey friends, in case you didn't know, I haven't been posting much on YouTube, so if you want to see my most current work, check me out on Rockfin at True Wrestling. Hey, what's up, you wrestling fanatics? You're listening to the True Wrestling Podcast, somewhere around episode 63. Thanks for tuning in. NCAA Championships just ended, and Jamie and I are going to do a little overview. Thanks for tuning in. I'd like to thank my sponsor, Adidas Wrestling. You can check them out at adidaswrestling.com. You can follow me on Twitter at TrueWrestler1. You can follow Jamie at Jamie Mosteller, or at PAISWT space underscore wrestle.
Yeah, that sounds right.
After we're done talking about the NCAAs, you check back later this week and you might be able to catch some interviews with some coaches and some wrestlers. So, Jamie, Iowa wins, right? And coming into it, you know, everybody thought they were kind of going to roll everybody. Including Penn State, a lot closer than anybody thought.
Oh, it was awesome. I mean, the way it finished was unreal. The Iowa had it locked up going into the finals. They had too many points in general across the board. But the way those finals were and what Penn State did is... it's reminiscent of the punt year, but oh my God, it was unreal.
Yeah. So, I mean, Iowa, I mean, I don't want to say this is a trend for them, but they clearly did not live up to their seeds for the most part. Penn State overperformed a bunch of their seeds, and they went 4-for-4 in the finals. I mean, I don't know who thought RBY was going to beat Fix. I thought Fix was going to win. RBY comes out with the win. We can get into the details each week, but you know, Lee reversing stuff, you know, Starocki and Brooks. I mean, 4-for-4, and right. I guess Lee's the elder statesman of the bunch, but I mean, Starocki, freshman, Brooks. I guess he's going to be a repeat freshman if this is a punt year. You know, or do over year. I mean, they're loaded here.
Yeah, it was unreal. I mean, they went into it 4 in the finals, only one on seeds who is favored, and they win all 4.
Penn State makes all the adjustments. Like, we've seen it before with Joseph, I can't think of anybody else right now, but maybe not doing their best work at Big Tens, but figuring something out and reversing things at NCAAs, it's truly an amazing amount of confidence and belief and coaching and preparing.
It started on day one, match one, and somebody made the comment about you give that Penn State team 2 weeks to prepare for an opponent, and match one, Howard beats
Heintzelman.
Who he lost to twice already.
Yeah.
And everybody, comments were being made. You give Casey and Kobe and Kale 2 weeks to prepare for an opponent, and more likely they're going to win. And match one of Penn State's tournament, they reverse something that they had lost two previous matches.
Yep. So I think we finish up with, is it Iowa 120? 129? I'm not sure. Can't read.
129, 113 and a half.
That was Penn State, Oklahoma State, 99 and a half, Arizona State, 74, Michigan, 69, NC State, then Minnesota, Missouri, Ohio State, Northwestern rounds at the top 10, then Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh had two finalists, which is good for Keith Gavin's program and, you know, for Pennsylvania wrestling fans. Then you had Nebraska, Iowa State, Rutgers with some young talent there, and Seabass maybe underperforming. Virginia Tech, North Carolina, Stanford comes in at 17 with a champ, and was it two finalists?
For NC State?
No, for Stanford.
Stanford had one, just Griffith.
Just Griffiths, right? Going out.
Save Stanford Wrestling.
Say it again?
Save Stanford Wrestling.
Absolutely. But they've raised more than $12 million. It's not about the money. There's an agenda there. After Stanford, Illinois, Northern Iowa, and Rider rounds out number 20. Actually, I'll go down to Utah Valley because they had some, I think they had at least one, I think they had two All-Americans.
Oh, Rider putting somebody in the finals. Delavecchia had a hell of a tournament. It's a shame he couldn't get it going, but that just to get there was impressive.
Absolutely. How do I turn off my camera, big guy?
I think just click on the video button down there at the bottom.
There we go. What else? So that was kind of the round around of the top 20. I'm going to say that, the seating was a little funky. The COVID, the lack of competition for a lot of these teams, and then, also the Big Ten not doing interconference rules, messed up the seating. And I think it led to a lot of schools getting on the podium that normally don't. So maybe it was good for wrestling.
Yeah, I mean, I think the seeds, good, bad, or indifferent, it didn't throw the bracket in total uproar where you had a ton of super high seeds come out of it, but you had plenty of high seeds make it to the semis. I think the talent leveled off at that point, but if you look at like EIWA, who was the biggest one, everyone was complaining about the seeds and all the qualifiers and how many they got. They had a horrendous tournament. And it kind of goes that their allocations were overinflated. And I feel bad for the other conferences that didn't get as many guys in, but the cream rises to the top. So if you were going to be one of the top, then you would have been there, but it was an impressive 3 days.
Yep. Another thing that stuck out to me, because for the last maybe 10 years, it's been like Penn State, Iowa, Ohio State. And Ohio State got rid of a lot of talent over the last 2 years, and they couldn't quite reload the way that Penn State and Iowa and maybe even Oklahoma State have. So I just think that's an interesting observation from my perspective. I don't know if it's the coaching. I've been critical of some of the stuff that's gone on there in the past, and I think they really miss Lou Rosselli's personality. Not just the coaching, but the personality in that room. But I don't know. And they have got a lot of talent. I would have bet on Sasso to win, and he didn't. So, I'm not sure what to say other than I don't think they're quite at the level right now of Iowa and Ohio or Penn State and maybe even Oklahoma State on the ability to just keep rolling along.
No, I mean, even in the Big Ten, I mean, they're behind Michigan and Purdue, Illinois, some of the other not as always – powerhouses, they showed a lot of fight. Michigan State had some people in there. I mean, the Big Ten kind of showed its depth where they had some of the other teams really start to jump up there, and Ohio State didn't have it. And some of these teams have track records of not performing at the NCAAs. Penn State's got this track record of overperforming, and some of that held true.
Yeah. A couple other things that just stuck out to me, Jamie. It seemed like a bunch of lightweight guys that made the quarterfinals didn't All-American. And I didn't notice it with the upper weights, but I thought that was an interesting kind of, I don't know if that was a lack of resiliency or speaks to just the parity at some of those weights. But, you know, when you make it to the quarterfinals and you don't AA, that feels like a soul-crushing experience.
Well, I heard a lot of people talk about the guts and the grit it takes when you lose that quarterfinal match, knowing that if you win, you're an AA. If you lose, you're now battling through the backside and the blood round. And like you said, some of them just didn't have the heart to get through it and fight. And kind of the reverse. Those guys are on the backside. They realize it's now or never. And they're just got to win at all costs kind of mentality. And some of those guys, there's a bunch of guys that came through deep in the consies. And it's a challenge. But that quarterfinal, those guys having to come back and wrestle again that same night and try to save their season and get in there. And like you said, the lower weight didn't do it.
Yeah. A couple other things. Wyatt Sheets, lowest seeded guy to All-American, came in, I think it was whatever the lowest seed is, 33?
He had the benefit of some medical forfeits in there, yeah, to help him along, but he did the job. He had those pigtail matches, and kudos to him.
Yeah, easy to quit when you got that. Was that six matches, seven matches?
He had to have a lot.
Yeah. Pennsylvania led the way with All-Americans. I tried to count. I think it's 18, but I could be wrong. I'm sure someone's going to do a better job at that. Illinois came in second, I think.
I think PA was 17 with seven in the finals.
Okay. I think, to my knowledge, Illinois has produced a lot of good wrestlers in the past. The university is, I don't want to say underperformed, University of Illinois, but the state has also maybe not had as many kids do well after high school. And I think they had seven. I think they were the second most besides Pennsylvania of any state.
I heard some conversations this weekend about that kind of same thing, about how Illinois is perennial Fargo winner at freestyle Greco cadet and junior ages. And like you said, to your point, they've not always seen that transition to the college level success, and they started to turn it around. There's a handful they're starting to turn it around. Izzy Style, his club, has got a number of guys doing it, and they definitely are on the upswing for sure. Illinois would have been better if Mikey Carr had been healthy, but
no doubt.
So far, so good.
The biggest thing, no one has confirmed this with me, but you think we should just keep going or not?
Yeah.
Okay. I think there was a referee shortage this year. I saw a couple of referees that were barely reffing at the college level just a couple years ago, reffing in the Big Tens this year. And I think that kind of showed with some of the consistency. The most obvious thing that at Nationals was just the quickness of some pins.
Or not some pins, yeah. That was the one of the early themes on Twitter was the speed in which pins were called for or against the more prominent singlets in a lot of cases.
Yeah. All right. I got three people, top three for the OW. Who do you have?
So there was three number ones that won the whole tournament. That has got to be unprecedented. I'll wait to see everyone write it up in the post tournament, but three of seven weights where the number one wins and seven they don't, that just seems hard to believe. And
right, Lee, Brooks, Stevenson.
Right, exactly. It was all late. It was 84 heavyweight and 125. Three of the last five matches that were number ones that actually were able to hold seed. But as far as the OW, I mean, RBY beating Fix was huge. Lee Ironman were 1-2. That was kind of thought to be kind of neck and neck.
But he also went through Seabass. I'm sorry. He also went through Seabass.
Yeah, yeah. But Gable didn't get a major. Lee didn't get a major. Those were the first non-bonuses, I think, for both of them.
Yeah.
That's tough.
I'm going with Starocki.
That could be, yeah.
I mean, Kemmerer destroyed him 10 days ago. I mean, I don't want to say destroyed him, but toyed with him maybe. He dominated him. And I don't think anybody – I know Starocki came in as the 2, but I don't think anybody gave him a chance.
He was the 3.
Oh, the 3. I'm sorry. You're right. You're right. So he didn't dominate, but of picking somebody who reversed the biggest decision, if Stevenson would have really beat Paris up kind of like he did at Big Tens, I'd probably go to him because heavyweight might be the deepest weight or 41. But I'm going with Starocki for the upset.
Yeah, I think that's fair. That's totally fair to give him the OW for sure. That was impressive. The work they did to change that result, that was impressive.
Yeah, I'd follow that up with other Penn State. You call me a homer, but Lee and RBY, I think, would be right there too.
I mean, going into it, Penn State had 4 in the finals, but they were only favored in 1. And they were not – these weren't like toss-ups. I mean, Lee Ironman is more of a toss-up, but you look at it on paper, Fix is a big, big underdog. And so is Kemmerer. And they wrestled great matches. RBY had to fight through some questionable stalling and penalty points and that kind of stuff, and just got it done. And that performance was impressive.
So 33, RBY, Fix, DeSanto, Myers, Bird, McGee from ASU, Cannon, and Louis Hayes. RBY, Fix. I mean, RBY is a brand in and of himself. He really works hard at promoting himself and getting better. And Fix is one of the best wrestlers in the world. Great finals matchup. And for, you know, Roman Bravo Young to win that match, I think that gives him a whole new level of, I don't want to say respect, but of credentials.
Big time.
Right?
He went 0-0 on the first. Then he rode him out the entire second. He rode him the entire second. One of the things, and you can see they commented on that, these Penn State guys, that bulldogging that inside ankle when they're on top, they were getting long, long rides on people. Starocki won how many matches this year because he rode people out?
Yeah.
And Fix did the same, or
RBY.
RBY did the same thing to Fix. He rode him out with that ankle trap. And third period, he goes down. He deferred in the second. He goes down in the third. And Fix lets him up right off the whistle because he knows he's down already 2 points. He needs multiple takedowns to win it.
Yeah, the game planning, the tactics of RBY and all 4 Penn State wrestlers in the finals were superb. And, you know, they dictated the match. Fix 2 heartbreaking losses in the finals, right?
Overtime twice.
Yeah, and, you know, there was no headgear push or pull in this match or anything like that. And I know that he was suspended, may not have had as much competition as he would have liked coming in, but he was working out and he was training with the team.
Oh, yeah.
So
I'm curious to see. He looked big at 33. He looks Fix. Thick. He looks full. He
looks huge.
For him to get down to another 8 pounds in 10 days, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
That's gonna wear on him that month.
Yeah,
it'll be interesting. Spencer on top of it. He said he has got no ACLs fixes. We're gonna try and cut 8 pounds in 2 weeks. Trials is gonna be interesting.
It's gonna be. I wish we were going.
I know.
141. Are you ready to go up to 141?
Yeah, absolutely.
So we had Nickley, Ironman, Wilson, Rivera, Duncan, Red, Sherman, and Carlson. Obviously, you got the big three, Lee, Ironman, and Rivera from Rutgers. And, you know, I picked Rivera to win the Big Tens. I was wrong. And, you know, I thought Lee could reverse it. But the big thing to me was, you know, Lee going through that bracket and beating Rivera and then reversing the Big Ten result when he lost to Ironman, it was more adjustments. And, you know, that Big Ten match, Lee took Ironman down quickly on a shallow shot with a quick finish, and he was winning, and they're back in neutral, and he looked like he took a test shot. And Ironman cut that corner and then rode him like a horse. And Lee just made some adjustments. It's incredible to think of changing your tactics just based on the results. It's incredible. I mean,
it was impressive. The game plan. He shot when he had to keep it active. He didn't take anything stupid. He reattacked on Ironman shots incredibly well. And the set of cojones on him to pull that inside trip in overtime in a match like that. When was the last time you saw Nick Lee hit an inside trip?
The first of February. I don't think I've seen it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right. So, I mean, let's just talk a little bit about the path. So, I mean, Lee is an offensive machine, and he comes in as the 2 Tech Fall major, and he, like the Rivera match at Big Tens was a 1-point match. It was, you know, I mean, some people were complaining because it was a penalty point, but locked hands is locked hands. But he opened it up 9-3 in the semis over Rivera. I don't know if Rivera's banged up, but those were some adjustments he made. So it wasn't just in the Ironman match. He made adjustments on Rivera to open that sucker up.
I think more so than against Lee, but against NC State in the 3-4 match, he did not look like he was able to handle the weight of going up to 41. Some of the things that in that match where he looked like he couldn't handle the extra size, the extra strength, the extra horsepower, and the NC State guy's just tall, lanky, but
yeah,
he seemed like he didn't have the same power and bullying kind of strength as he did down at 25 and 33 the last couple of years.
Yeah, you told me when that match was going on, like you could just see him small. And Rivera, I mean, I don't want to say his bread and butter was being quick. He was quick enough to get into Spencer Lee, right? And, you know, that speed needs a little more muscle when you go up in weight, and I'm not sure he had it.
Right. Yeah, it looked like he struggled with the size difference. And some of these guys, when they go up, it takes a year plus to get used to the weight, and this was not a full year. So he didn't have that full year of competition where he could really, really, really get used to that wrestling that many guys at that weight.
Just like I said for RBY, winning this bracket, the credentials on Lee change. The perception of Lee changes. He's not just an offensive dynamo anymore. Who's going to be an All-American. I mean, he's beaten national champions on the way to becoming a national champion. And, you know, and it wasn't a close match beating Rivera. I know he went up, and Ironman, you know, Ironman didn't figure on changing strategies. You know, anyway, I'm just impressed with Lee's performance, and if he's the OW, I wouldn't complain.
No, I think there's no doubt he is a candidate for OW. I mean, he looked as surprised as anyone after he won. I mean, the look on his face was like, oh, my God.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Go up to 49?
Yep.
All right, so O'Connor, Sasso, Thomas, Boo, Mahler, can't read my own writing, Abbas, and Milner. Let me see who was the guy from Fresno, Fresno State.
Parco.
Yep, that's Fresno State's All-American after their but actually Parco and Abbas, Stanford. I was conflating Abbas with Fresno State too. Both programs in the last years getting an All-American. You know, I think most people thought that this bracket was going to be Sasso. You know, he comes in and he's pretty dominant all of the short season. He had a pin, a decision. Then he pinned Boo in the semis. And, you know, O'Connor, major decision, sudden victory, tiebreaker one. And I did, you know, O'Connor is strong. I don't think he's dynamic, but his match strategy, I thought, was also really good. He wanted that thing to be a 1-point match, and not get caught up in getting into a wild flurry with Sasso. And he won. He won the match strategy and won the national championship.
No, I don't disagree. I mean, he definitely wrestled a smart match. I think it's ironic for Ohio State of how that position that the match ended in has gone down in lore, because that is exactly the position that Jordan Oliver had.
Yep. Logan Stieber.
Stieber in, and he didn't get the call, and then Sasso is in the exact same position, and I saw people saying, well, having the side of the foot is not the same as having the back of the foot, but I don't know that the rule is written that clear, but I personally thought that, based upon how I understand the rule, that should have been a takedown. So I felt bad for Sammy being a PA guy, wanting him to win.
Me too. I just wish he would have been more aggressive. You know, I love to see his wide open style and engage, and you know, it's one of those things where, you know, you're really good, but when you get to the NCAA finals, you can get really tight and you can start questioning yourself, as we saw a lot tonight with only 3 number one seeds getting the championship. I think this is Coleman Scott's first national champion. By the way, it was a takedown when Jordan Oliver had Logan Stieber. Stieber's a 3-time champ in my book.
I agree. I mean, that they changed the rule as a result, which means you're rewriting history, and you should give the credit. But I thought Sammy had enough of this foot to get the same call. And
I'm with you. I thought it was a takedown too. I really did. And I'm a Pennsylvania homer, but it just speaks to the inconsistency that the referees have on, we already mentioned, pins, but takedowns. But they never change the fact that there's not supposed to be reaction time, yet they give them reaction time again. It's like when you have a rule and you don't follow it, the referees have all sorts of latitude.
Speaking of the referees, the one thing I'll say that I am pleasantly, well, I have mixed opinions on, the independent review was good in that, and I think the numbers prove it out, a number of calls were overturned where most referees don't ever overturn themselves.
Correct. I couldn't agree with you more.
The problem is it took way too long. Right. Everybody was commenting on that. The announcers harped on it, that they're like, oh, on football, an average review takes 2 minutes. And they were like, 2 minutes is an eternity for a wrestling match to sit and wait.
Yeah. Yeah, the wrestler's got to stay intense. I mean, there's all sorts of complications that go in there.
So. Right. So the independent review is good for getting the right call. It's bad for interrupting the flow of the match.
Yeah. I want to call out Northwestern wrestler Yaya Thomas. Came in as a 25th seed, lost to Sasso in the quarters, and then did yeoman's work. Yeoman's work on the backside, and he beat Abbas from Stanford. He beat Brock Mahler, and then he beat Boo for third and fourth. So, you know, I always liked him. I thought he was going to do better in the Big Ten, and he didn't. But, you know, I guess he's a bright lights kind of guy.
Oh, absolutely. He was a 25th seed. He came in, beat the 8, beat the 9, or vice versa.
Yep.
And obviously, Sasso is a big task to handle to beat him. But and then he made a run on the backside and kind of legitimized his results. So, yeah, that was impressive. Boo. He did. He's almost the road warrior of the tournament. That was impressive.
Yep. 57?
Yeah.
I think everybody...
Delvecchio showed his power on top against Deacon when he was able to pull the upset and get the pin, which was not in doubt in any question. He was flattered in any of the guys of half the pins in the tournament, and they called it, thankfully. But I don't think he got a chance on top at all in the finals.
Yeah, I don't think he hit his stride. I mean, first of all, coming in, I don't think anybody thought Deacon was going to have serious competition. I mean, he just really dominant.
Yeah.
You know, and he wrestled close. Everything was a decision. He gets to Delavecchia, and I'm gonna talk to Jesse tomorrow or the next day. I don't think he was ready for that suck back maneuver with a half Nelson, which is Delavecchia's bread and butter. On the bottom side, if you would have made me, you know, put a gun to my head before the tournament and said pick 5 guys are gonna make the finals, I would have, Hayden Heidley would have been one of those 5 guys. But I'll tell you what, Dave Carr changed my mind, and you know, he ends up beating Delavecchia in the finals. But, you know, I mean, Carr's got the pedigree. I mean, his dad is a national champion. What, a world and Olympic champion, or just an Olympic champion, Nate?
World for sure. I'm going off of what they said in the broadcast. I don't think he won Olympic. He was in the Olympics. I don't think he won it.
Okay. I mean, he had the best strategy, I think, for wrestling Delavecchia really tight and under control in the finals. I did not see the Heidley match. Did you see that?
I did, and it was there was a late score, I feel like. But I think he won a couple of the scrambles. I think it's kind of where it came out of. He won a couple of scrambles on his feet, and Hayden usually is more sound and more positionally solid to where he doesn't get into those that he can't lose. And then Hindley lost. Who did he lose to in the Consies?
He ended on the backside. He ended up losing to.
He got pissed because he lost in the Consi semis this morning. But,
so Heidley lost to Teamer 18-12.
Yeah.
And then he lost to Brayton Lee 11-2.
Teamer hit him on something that got a bunch of points and got him on his back early, I think. And then Heidley went takedown release for a while and started picking up points, but he was just down so much and he just didn't have a chance.
Well, he gave up 29 points in the last 2 matches. I bet if you looked at every match before the tournament for all season and all of last year, he didn't give up 29 points combined.
Oh, I agree.
I mean, there was something happened. Like, that was just I mean, it's just weird, a weird thing, and you know, weird things happen at national championships. A couple more things I wanted to mention about Carr. He freshman, he is, you know, Kevin Dresser's first national champ, I think, since being at Iowa State. But I don't know who is more excited, Dresser, Carr, or Brett Metcalf, who I thought was going to take him out after the match. I mean, you would have thought Metcalf just won.
That was the best post-match celebration. That was so, so tongue-in-cheek, so kitschy, so classic. That was awesome. It was just like, Metcalf has nothing to do with backflips, and he's going to just take you out, whether you're NC State or whether you're your home team. He's going to take you out. That's awesome.
Yeah. So good for Kevin Dresser. I mean, he's clearly built in Iowa State. And, you know, Carr, as young as he is, I mean, I guess he's got four more years after this. He could be a five-time champ. All right. Yeah. I'm getting ahead of myself. But the idea is they have a young nucleus to build around. So good for Kevin Dresser and that staff. Who's the not besides Metcalf? It's St. John, Derek St. John.
Yeah.
With Della Vecchia, that's Ryder's first finalist. And I know Ryder, I mean, they were in a lockdown state of lockdown states in Jersey. Hard for them to get the season going. I think they ended up cutting half of their team just because of the cost of testing. It's just good for a small program like that. Nick Bedleon, I think, punched Della Vecchia in the face after winning, or slapped him in the face. That's the coach. I mean, that's just awesome wrestling celebrations.
And hey, I'm seeing on Twitter now, it looks like Shane Griffith was OW.
Okay. I get maybe that's a play to help Stanford reconsider, but
yeah, it's possible. It looks like that's kind of what's trending on Twitter right now, is it, well, same Stanford wrestling has been trending large in general, but I think I'm just trying to look here to see. Same Stanford wrestling was number two or three on trending for a while there, but it looks like, from what I'm seeing, is he got OW.
Gotcha. All right. I won't argue.
I think Spencer Lee's knee has now replaced it. He's a little high. It's trending a little higher. But I do believe, I think they gave the OW to Shane Griffith, which is very well deserving. He's a number eight seed.
Yep.
He beat the one.
Yep.
I don't know if the four came out in that bracket or not, but that was 65 was a almost Marinelli next topic kind of discussion, and he just went through it.
Hey, I just want a couple more things I wanted to say about 57. I thought Ja'Cory Teamer, you know, he came back after losing and went quite a way on the backside. So I think he ended up taking fourth, losing to Deacon. And Deacon, after that heartbreaking loss, I am sure he's never felt a suck back. He looked like he was confused and wasn't ready and couldn't. It would be easy for him not to be ready for the third, fourth place match. But he came back and beat Teamer for third and fourth. And we already mentioned that Sheets here finished eighth as a 33 seed. You know, if the only other thing I was going to say, if Berge from Penn State doesn't get injured, you wonder how it affects the team score.
Right. So he was in the spot to win some matches and get some more points. Again, yeah, like you said, you have to go back, look at the math and do all that, but it certainly looked like they were in the, they had a chance.
Yep. And when they were doing the team trophy presentation, I think I mentioned to you, I mean, his leg was locked down in a very long brace. I'm guessing the ACL at least is gone, but holy cow. You know, could have, who knows. All right. Going to 65, we already said, you know, the bull went down. I mean, this is the third tournament where he's come in and, you know, it just hasn't happened for him. And 2 years ago, was it 2 years ago at Pittsburgh where he had the murderer's row of like Joe Smith and, you know, I guess it was Mekhi or somebody else, and that, I mean, it was just a murderer's row, and, you know, Mekhi knocked him off. Was that Mekhi? I think.
That was, well, 2 years ago being the last tournament we actually had. So, yeah, it was when we were in Pittsburgh. He had Joe Smith in the round of 16. And then he might have had Evan Wick and then Mekhi in the semis.
I think you're right. Right? And here he is. He loses to Griffith in sudden victory from Stanford. I mean, and then, you know, you get him over on the other side, and
word has he has a broken rib or something to do with that, and he medical forfeited out.
Yeah, to him. Yep, to a mean. Yeah. And look, I've seen the documentary with the Stickleys, and yeah, I like him, but I mean, there's something going on, right? There's just something mentally here. I know you can get injured any time, but you know, three tournaments and. I don't think he placed. I don't know. Feel bad for him. On the other hand, the feel-good story, apparently the OW, Shane Griffith from Stanford, you know, he comes in from the 8 seed and, you know, gets a decision, two decisions, ends up beating Marinelli in sudden victory, beats Hartman from Bucknell, and then takes out Jake Wenzel. Yeah, I hate to see a Pennsylvania guy go down like that, but it is what it is. Wenzel ended up beating Ethan Smith. There were a couple interesting things about the bracket to me. Is that Smith, Ohio State, you know, he knocks off a guy with a name, Travis Whitlake, and then ends up losing to him in the consolations, which, you know, Whitlake, you know, and there's some mental toughness. The tournament, you're not having the tournament you want, but you still fight back, beat the guy who beat you, and you take fourth, losing to O'Toole. You know, one of the interesting things about O'Toole, you know, the Askren Wrestling Academy is starting to make some waves here. And
big time.
Say it again.
Big time, big time. The Kekhuizen and Keegan are the two kind of the shining beacons from that club right now, but. Absolutely. The number of guys coming out of Wisconsin is the quality of the guys coming out of Wisconsin is upping, is getting very much much better for sure.
Yep. Sad to see Mekhi Lewis just medical forfeit out. I'm guessing we won't see him at Olympic trials, but I mean, I hope that we do.
Is he qualified?
Well, he was a national champion.
Not this year.
Oh, I thought it was the last 3 years. Is it just this year?
I'm not positive. I'm with you on the. I'm disappointed that you hate to see anybody have to quit because of injury. So that is rough for sure.
You know, it gave a chance for Bucknell to get All-American. Zach Hartman. On the bottom side, you know, Anthony Valencia came in as a 2 seed. I mean, he was the more highly touted recruit coming out of high school, and his college, you know, freshman year was good, and it just never seemed to get better. I don't know if he's banged up, if he's not interested, or if he's got some of Zahid's problems. I don't know anything about him, but. You know, he lost to Ethan Smith in the quarters, and it wasn't close.
He got hurt. He got hurt in that match when he lost in the championship side. He popped a hamstring or something. He was visibly banged up, and the match went totally south for him from that point once he got hurt. It sucks that kind of happened because – yeah. I'm talking about a guy that coming out of high school, he was beating college guys in freestyle and then gets to college and wasn't having the success his brother was. And everyone's like, what's going on? What's happening? And I was glad to see he had a kind of a rebound year. Sucks that he got hurt. And when he lost to O'Toole in the backside, you could see he was on the bottom. he just couldn't. He didn't have the power in the leg to kind of even attempt to stand up. No and kidding. Jewel just kind of tilted and turned him pretty easily.
We had a major the first match against Hall from West Virginia, and then got teched. Look, at least he finished. I think he got his first All American honors. So
he did. Yeah. Eighth
place. So, you know, Ethan Smith, one of those guys who came all the way to the quarters and then didn't have the best backside there, where he ends up losing to Whitlake, who he had just beaten, and Whitlake opened up the score. So, I mean, really competitive. It just tells you how hard. This is one of the hardest tournaments in the world. You know, at the international level, they don't have wrestle backs, right? If you the guy who beat you is in the finals, you get sucked back into repechage.
Right.
But here, I mean, you could end up wrestling, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 matches, you know, easily just to get to an All-American position, just in the backside. So, I mean, it's impressive.
You know, Smith was not even the starter when the season started. Karchla beat him out.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure. I have not verified this. So Ohio State has a message board where you have to put your names on there, right? There's no anonymity, which keeps some of the crap down, I guess. I'm not a message board person, but it sounded like there was a lot of people not happy with the coaching staff before NCAAs, before Big Tens. And again, I think they need someone who can put some energy in the emotional bank account in a sincere way over there as a leader. That's my perspective. And I took a lot of hate mail for saying that last year.
I think they're missing Roselli more than they are willing to admit.
Yeah, he's got a personality. You know, and then when he left, Tervo was there for a while, and he has a totally different personality, but the same type of stereotype as Roselli, if you ask me. And he was able to, I think, create something there, and I think he's gone, right? I don't think he's there right now. I don't know.
Who?
Delagnov. Is he still coaching?
Say the name again.
Tervo Delagnov.
Oh, I think he is. I think he's doing the OTC. Maybe he's not on staff at the university.
Maybe. All right.
But
anyway,
I had to laugh earlier in the tournament when Sasso pinned somebody in a cradle, and they're like, "Jay Jagger's taught in that." And I was offended, and I'm like, Sasso's been doing that cradle long, long before he got to Ohio State.
Since 10th grade.
Now, something to say, what kind of disrespect is Nashville Wrestling getting here? Because Sammy has been doing that forever. Forever.
Yeah.
Go to Flo's. Who's number one? He pinned somebody in a cradle. Because no disrespect to Jay Jaggers, but Sammy knew the cradle long before he got to Ohio State.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny. I watched the finals on, where there was no announcing, whatever the feed was. I had pictures of the parents and then the match and the coaches, and it was. I have to say, I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed not. You could hear the PA announcer, but I enjoyed that. The lack of, you know, it's like watching a baseball game with the out of town announcer. It's just not as fun when because they don't know the teams intimately or the wrestlers. It's hard to.
Right.
So, and look, I hope Griffith's OW and Save Stanford Wrestling gains traction. They got $12 million. They could keep that program going. Stanford already has what, 20 billion or whatever it is. They don't need this, but they could just run the program off that $12 million for a long time. A long
time. And Stanford Athletic Department had the balls to tweet out congratulations to Shane, and everybody is just ripping and responding like, really? Now you're going to show some respect for the team that is wearing their singlets inside out, all black, to hide your logo because you won't give them anything. And after the fact, you want to
front run them?
That's on their coattails?
Yeah, I mean, I know that the administration was really angry with the coaching staff for their Twitter account. They locked them out during the season. I know that there's a lot of animosity there. I don't know if there's too much water under the bridge, but, you know, I mean, Stanford, you know, is cutting a ton of sports. You know, there's other sports like this where, you know, wrestling fans are cultists. They will do everything for that sport. The Big Ten was surprised at they shattered viewership numbers this year. And, you know, I think it's the third most popular sport now behind basketball and football, or football than basketball, on the Big Ten network. You know, I hope that it can be resolved. Like, there needs to be a mediator. I'll just say that I think the NWCA leadership is, nothing nice to say, not going to say it. So anything else about that?
No, just the whole idea that it's like, okay, you have $20 billion in endowments, and you're saying that, okay, we're going to cut sports, and you're cutting 11 sports. Some small, not all of those are even NCAA sports. There's like yachting and two-man yachting and four-man yachting and some of these that are not even NCAA sports. Fine. Yeah. If you want to cut the fat, go for it. But when you come back and say it's all or nothing, it's all or nothing. You have to everybody's got to come back or nobody. And then you kind of give these ultimatums and this and that. And then the wrestling community independently is like, we got $12 million for us. We can endow our own selves for perpetuity. And how can they not listen to that? The West Coast is dying in wrestling. And this will be traumatic. If Fresno State's the other one getting lost in the conversation because they cut them after a 7-year absence and they spent all the money and effort to get them back, and they're looking to be cut. And the West Coast losing those one or two of those teams is going to be huge. It's critical. I mean, the California is a one-state program where you win a state title there. That's freaking huge. And those kids are now going to be like, fine, I go out of state. I'm going to leave. And it's horrible.
Yeah. I don't know if there's a mediator there or anything. All I know is that I hope that it can be resolved. And it's, you know, I'm hoping that this publicity is good for the program and build some goodwill. But it's got to be from the administration, because at this point, the wrestling team and community have done everything. The coaches and the kids wrestled their butts off. They did crazy stuff to qualify for NCAAs. The coaches had them ready, and they performed. And you know, this shows a certain level of commitment in the face of, you know, being executed here. The program is going to be shot and buried, and they went out and they weren't dissuaded. They didn't lose their cool, and they came to NCAAs ready to wrestle.
I forget what podcast it was, they talked to Jason Borelli about the adversity they trained in this year because California being under strict lockdown.
Yeah.
They practiced outside probably more this year than they did inside. They practice outside, mats on the grass in 30-degree, 50-degree weather. They traveled to somewhere to get some practices. They stayed in a hotel for 30 days. I mean, these guys did everything and anything they could do just to stay ready and try to do this. I mean, Stanford in the past was the NCAA leader in that championship cup that they hold for number one team, number one championships won across all sports.
Yep.
And they've been the leader in that for years. Shane Griffith was the Pac-12 Scholar Athlete of the Year. I mean, these are kids that aren't just going there and showing up. They talk about diversity. Stanford's wrestling team is – the diversity is at 45%, where the university average is at 12%. I mean, these guys are doing everything right. It's got to be resolved. It's got to be fixed.
I don't usually don't talk about it. I donated a little money to the Save the Program thing back when it first came out, and you know, I didn't know if it would make a difference. And when you have an administration that's dug in like this, they've backed themselves into a corner. And I, you know, we know one thing about college administrators, whether it's Boise State or ODU, or I could, the list can go on. College administrators,
Eastern Michigan,
Central, yeah, there's very little accountability for them, and you know, it's I don't know, I don't want to go on, but anything to close that up.
24, Carter Starocki.
This is the Star Man. My new nickname for him, Star. You know, coming into it, I thought Chem Dog was going to be the guy. You know, in his first several matches, tech fall, major decision. And then you think he's going to get to Labriola, another stud, and Cal Poly has an upset. You know, Bernie Truex, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know if he beats Labriola in the front side 4-2, but loses to him on the backside for third place. But still, another California school, Poly showing up there, and, you know, I hate to see Labriola go down, but he did yeoman's work in the backside and, you know, reversed that decision. Starocki, I'm sorry. Do you have anything you want to say up there, Jamie, before I keep going?
No, just the only thing I would add is that Stanford, Cal Poly, these aren't community colleges. These are like the top 5-10 academic universities in the country. These kids are not just athletes. These are freaking smart kids getting it done, and they're not getting the all the attention. I mean, yeah, Bernie Truax, whatever his name is, awesome. Absolutely freaking phenomenal tournament. Cal Poly's probably been on the cutting block in the past, and They're putting it through. That just awesome. His performance to get to the semis was just great.
Right, he took fourth All American. Cal Poly probably hasn't had All American in at least 6-7 years that I'm aware of. And they probably had a final. Who was the finalist? Did Jaggers beat a guy from Cal Poly in the finals? When I think the kid got. I think Jaggers got a favorable call. I don't remember. I'm an old guy. I don't remember that kind of stuff. You know, the last famous alumni from Cal Poly was Tom Cruise in All the Right Moves or something.
Yeah.
Is that movie too old for you, Jamie?
No, I remember that.
All right. On the bottom side.
Tidy whitey for me, though.
What's that?
No, too much tidy whities for me.
Oh, man. Am pipe. Bottom side, we had Demetrius Romero, Utah Valley come as a 2, Starocki is the 3. You know, Starocki, you know, he is not putting up bonus points like some guys are, but this guy might have one of the highest wrestling IQs I've ever seen. You know, he finds a way to win, and you know, he beats Romero 2-0. What do you see that match?
I think so. Yeah, it's kind of mind-boggling because the season started off slow and Nittany Lion was doing a bunch of freestyle events, And Ciraki is like this offensive dynamo teching people in freestyle. And you're like, awesome. This is just going to be David Taylor, Ed Ruth kind of reincarnated. And then we go into college and 3-2 overtime, 2-1 overtime, ride out overtime. And it's like he just is winning these barn burners by riding people out. And it's like, what happened to the offensive dynamo? And I mean, you win. You can't complain. But I was just shocked to see the difference in his offensive output going from freestyle to folk style. But hell, he gets it done.
I mean, yeah. If I had to guess, the biggest difference we'll see between this year and next year for him is just some upper, I feel like some upper body strength maybe. But I'm not sure. Like, Kimmerer has some heavy freaking hips, and he is strong, right? I mean, he is a strong guy. But, like, you know, Star, you know, he got dominated by Kimmerer at the Big Ten Finals. I don't know if it was a major, but it was a dominant performance. And, you know, Star ended up adjusting so much. It, you know, in the first period, just his tie-ups were short, so he wasn't out of balance. And those out-of-balance positions at the Big Tens let Kimmerer get in there. When he was just leaning on that tie, the tie would be too deep, and he'd get off balance, and Kimmerer would get in deep. And, you know, the way he kept his head position, you could see him fighting for head position to create some length. It just neutralized a lot of Kemmerer's strength, and Kemmerer couldn't get to angles because of Staraki's head position.
Lot of it just goes to, I mean, this was not a full season. We know historically we have seen these Penn State guys grow, improve as the years go on, as they get in the room, as they work, as they go through the season. And they peak in the end, and obviously they did that. They many of them really, really, really peaked and overperformed from what they were seeded or whatever. But these young guys just didn't have that seed. I mean, they had one tournament.
Yeah.
Big Ten.
Yep.
That was their only tournament aside. They had the Nittany Lion event, which actually that Nittany Lion event didn't have the college kids where they did multiple matches. These guys have not done a 2-day tournament. They've not done a 3-day tournament. They've not had the grind of going through that stuff and adjusting and that. So the 2-week training and adjustment that they made from Big Ten to Nationals, oh my God, it was just freaking unreal.
Absolutely. And, you know, so that was Strachey was the third of four finalists. And, you know, when he beats Kimmerer, you know, it is any youth wrestlers, any dads, any coaches. Kimmerer lost that match in sudden victory because he stood up. He broke position. And that's all Strachey needed. And he got in deep. Kimmerer's chest was up. You can just see it. Like, it was just, even national champions make basic mistakes. You can't lose a match if you don't get out of position. You might not win. It might be a tie. But if Kimmerer, the second, that was the first time he broke position, and Staraki was ready in sudden victory.
That was the first two Penn State matches, I was like, clear. There's no doubt I have 100% rooting interest for Penn State. The last two, Kimmerer and Hidley being Pennsylvania boys as well, I was kind of like, I really want Penn State to win, but at the same time, I feel bad for the other guys because Kimmerer is just a freaking, he's just class act. He's just been a warrior all this time. His bump up from 57 to 74, the battles he had with Mark Hall last year, But Soraki's improvement to shut down the neutral game and then get the to get that win in overtime was just awesome.
Well, Jamie, this is as good a time as any to talk about this because, you know, I mean, it's a sensitive subject. I mean, all right, Iowa wins, but, like, you know, Kemmerer doesn't feel good about his performance. You know, Marinelli got injured, but, you know, DeSanto was acting out. And Lee's banged up, but who else? Ironman, right? Who else? You know, Caleb Young underperformed and
Murin.
I mean, is this something that the Brands brothers, do you think, or the coaching staff is missing in preparation for nationals, or is it who they're recruiting or some kind of combination? Thoughts?
Well, I mean, the reason they got to win the title this year, in all honesty, is they had half their lineup was from Pennsylvania. I mean, Lee, DeSanto, Kemmerer, Young, Murin. I mean, these are PA guys. And now some of them didn't perform. I mean, Murin ended up only scoring 2 points with DNP. Caleb Young, 7th place, 8.5 points. Marinelli, number one seed, DNP's 4 points in the tournament. Elgin Brands DNP, but I think his seed is kind of what it was expected. They did not seal the deal. I mean, because they had 10 and they had the volume. They won it on volume, but their horses did not get the job done at the end.
Yeah. Well, I will say that, you know, they were, you know, on the bubble. I think they had like a 3rd and a 4th place finish, whenever it was, 4 years ago. And they came to Pennsylvania and they recruited Spencer Lee and they got Kemmerer and Teasdale. All right, we'll leave Teasdale out of it. But they got a bunch of these first. Pennsylvania
Kemmerer
guys.
Kemmerer was first, and he was the one that was the catalyst. And then I think he was actually Caleb Young, technically, I think, was first. But Kemmerer came on, and then he kind of started pulling some of the other guys. He may have pulled in Spencer. Spencer absolutely pulled in DeSanto.
What do they do? They got the
no doubting that that young guns. As much as Jody is kind of neutral in all his comments about where he pushes his kids to and all that stuff, I think there's definitely a slight lean that the kids know that he came from Iowa and that kind of stuff, but that clearly is the difference. I mean, those PA kids are scoring the points.
Yeah, they didn't have anybody, I guess. I mean, if you compare the Iowa team and the Penn State team, I mean, the only one who really did not look good is Joe Lee, right?
Yes.
I don't know what's going on there, but like when you watch him wrestle, even during the season, he just doesn't look like he's figured out like college positions, which is like that's number one. So, and the point I'm making is, all right, Iowa can keep recruiting Pennsylvania kids and Ohio kids, but like if you're a high school standout right now, Iowa won the tournament, but you're looking at Penn State go 4-for-4 in the finals. And this is not something new. Like they went, 5 for 5 5 years ago.
They had 6 freshmen.
Yeah, I mean
Howard over. He doesn't place, but he outperforms his expectation.
Yep.
Bravo Young is the 2 seed. He gets first. Yep. Nick Lee's the 2 seed. Gets first. Bergie is out. He doesn't place. And he still outperforms his seed. Joe Lee, like you said, he was the kind of the outlier. He was 0-2. He He looked much better going into Big Ten than Big Tens, and he just kind of laid an egg. The Rockies, the 3 seed, he gets first. Brooks was the 1. He came in. He kind of did what he was supposed to. Beard, he was seated outside of his where he was supposed outside of the placing round, and he gets 7. Turkliet, everyone knows what talent he has, but he had so little preparation and all that kind of stuff. But he still plays, he's got a lot of points. This is a young, dangerous team. It's not quite the same as the punt year where they didn't win it, but it's like we just brought 6 freshmen to the tournament and we had 4 champs.
Yeah.
Not something you could be all that upset about.
Yeah, and they only brought 9. Iowa brought 10. We didn't have anybody at 49. You know, Bartlett didn't qualify. I'm assuming that, you know, next year he'll come in thinking that's his weight class and be full size. I know it took forever to figure things out and where people were going. And look, it was a bizarre year. So kids got, you know, it's hard to figure things out when half the team is at home in isolation. So anyway, Shtiraki is a guy, Pennsylvania champ. He had some wars with Niehaus, you know, in the Pennsylvania states and the regionals. It's nice to see him stay home and be a champion right off the bat. And, you know, I hate seeing PA on PA violence in the finals, but a PA kid won, so.
Yeah, that was one where, like I said, I had a little bit of mixed emotion. I mean, Kemmerer was in high school, was a 4-time finalist. He didn't win until his senior year. Who knows if he'll come back for a 7th or 8th year of college, whatever he's up to. I would like to see him get one, but I wasn't going to get too upset with the fact that Shtiraki got that. That was a big, big win. That was huge.
Yeah.
Great for him.
Again, those adjustments, incredible. All right, let's keep moving on here so we don't lose everybody. 84, Aaron Brooks comes in as the 1. Heidley comes in as the 2. Bolin and Venz. And, you know, Brooks, you know, 1 tech fall, but it's pretty much all decisions to the finals. You know, Venz beat him earlier in the year. He beat him pretty Brooks beat him pretty convincingly. You know,
Early last year.
Oh, was that last year?
Yeah, okay. Venz beat him early last year. He pinned him in Big Tens and hasn't lost since.
Nelson Brands didn't do much on the top side. Askin Wrestling Academy. Parker Kekkeisen met Brooks in the semis and probably gave him his toughest match other than in the finals. And who else here? Binghamton's Deprez, you know, he ended up losing to the Rutgers freshman.
Poznanski looked good. Yeah. He's going to be good.
You know, and he's got quite the story, you know, loss of vision, all this stuff. Young guy, but he is driven. And, you know, he's a local New Jersey guy staying home, helping that team out because they need help. You know, we talk about Ohio State not reloading. Rutgers has not been able to. I thought we'd see development from a couple of those guys, and it just didn't seem to happen. So Heidley comes out of the 2, Tech fall, decision, and then he gets Poznanski and wins in a tiebreaker, 2-1. You know, that's two Rutgers guys I think were All-Americans. He ended up losing to Kekkeisen for 3-4 by a point. But, you know, as a freshman, that's young talent, and that's good for him. You know, Dakota Gear ended up taking 5th. Hunter Bolden took 7th over Binghamton's DePerez. You know, I'm glad Binghamton got an All-American. Stutzman, you know, he's one of those guys. I wonder if he regrets leaving Bloom. He had Bloom as a top 20 team. He's a New York guy, And it just doesn't seem like he – I mean, he's been up there 7 years maybe. I just don't know if he's going to be able to build Buffalo into a team. I mean, like he was – and he was doing it at a PSAC school, which they pay terrible. They have very low scholarships. I mean, it's – I mean, the pay – I mean, the local mechanic makes more pay than the head coach there. So I'm glad he got some recognition there, and Heidley ends up facing Brooks in the finals, and it was a lot closer than I thought it was going to be.
I agree, because the last time they wrestled, I think it was a Fargo final where Aaron Brooks blew him out of the waters 10-0, 12-0, something like that.
It was a tech ball, I think.
I was surprised it was that close.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, I think Brooks Heidley didn't break position, and Brooks didn't want to take a bad shot and give up quick points. And Heidley's whole strategy, which is very smart when you're against someone who is so slick on his feet, is a 1-point match, and he almost had it. Like that review, that takedown at the end of the match, I didn't have a great angle on it. I'm on the TV, whatever. It was really close. Right, and but they upheld their call. Surprise, surprise! I know, independent review, right, Jamie?
Yeah, no, it's totally independent, which is good. It's slow, but I was surprised. I did not expect that to be that close. I thought Brooks was gonna be same old, and have a pretty good time with it. And it was close. I'll give Hidley credit. I mean, Hidley has had a great year. I mean, you look what he did at the RTC Cup. And then, the appendicitis. He was off the mat for a while. That was impressive. Hidley's going to be a force for a while. But Brooks got it done. It was just simple. He knew enough. He knew what he had to do. He did enough to get it done. And he kind of backed up what he expected to do last year when he was number one seed as well.
Yeah. I mean, he's just a winner. AB is a winner. And, it's going to take a lot to knock him off. I think that his heart is in international wrestling. Because while he can ride you a little bit, he's not dominant like David Taylor was on top, or anybody who is, being mentioned as a possible 4-time champ. He is so good on his feet, but he seems to be able to get out this year. I know last year was a little bit of trouble, but I think for him to go down as one of the best wrestlers possibly, not only in Penn State, but NCAA wrestling, he's going to develop a top game.
No doubt. No doubt.
One other guy I wanted to mention was Northern Illinois, Britt Wilson. They had an All-American, number 6. I don't know the last time Northern Illinois had an All-American. So, good for him. He took 6th place. And I mentioned Binghamton getting an All-American, but Northern Illinois doesn't get much. I'm guessing most wrestling fans don't know they're a D1 team. So congratulations, and I hope you keep building on that.
Exactly. No, that's big. If nothing else, that with the COVID and the questionable allocations and all that stuff, it was good to see some of these other small programs show out. Fresno, Cal Poly, NIU,
Utah Valley,
Rider, Utah Valley. Yeah, so awesome to see these traditional small schools get out there and show that they got some talent as well.
Yep. All right, going up to 97, we had Miles Amin coming in as the one. So we ended up with AJ Ferrari, Bonacorsi, Amin, Warner, Elam, Woodley, Beard.
Woodley coming out of the 25, 26, whatever, yep. Making the semis. Bonacorsi talking about how he was disappointed to be the friend because they're both Pittsburgh boys. I don't know the age difference and whether how much they battled in high school and all that kind of stuff, if close to age. I just felt like Nino went soft in the finals. He didn't shoot, put the pressure on Ferrari, and there's no denying Ferrari's talent. Personally, I think his persona is annoying, but he's a talent on the mat. Cannot deny that the kid knows how to wrestle.
Yeah, we've talked about it. I love his stick. I just think he's interesting, and I like personality because everybody's so monoculture or they have personality within this 3x5 card of allowable opinion, and Ferrari's out there. And the one thing that I've noticed from watching him is good wrestlers look like they should be in the match with him, but they're exhausted. Like watching the Big 12s, I mean, the guy he was wrestling in the finals was dripping sweat. It was, and the same thing I think happened within the Amin match. At the end of the match, they showed Amin in the bottom, on the bottom position getting ready, and he was exhausted, and it looked like a small stream was pouring off of his head, right? Like it was, he was,
yeah.
I Ferrari made him work, and, you know, Ferrari was my pick coming in, but Amin is a super talented wrestler. Like he's qualified for the Olympic Olympic team for San Marino through his Italian or San Marinan ancestry.
He got fifth in the world last year.
Yeah, really good. And Ferrari beat him on his feet, which, you know, I mean, you get fifth in the world by being good on your feet and not getting taken down. And Ferrari took him down, I think, twice and rode him. I mean,
I do think the – now, he wrestles 86 kilos freestyle, which is 189, and he did not want to cut weight for the college season to 184, so he bumped to 97. And I honestly believe he just wasn't quite as – strong and athletic of a competitor up at 97 as he would have been at 84, but you understand while he's doing it, it's the Olympic year and all that kind of stuff. But all things on a normal year, he's wrestling 84 and he's going to give Aaron Brooks a hell of a battle.
I'm with you. I think you're right. And it's been talked about his weight and all that stuff. He didn't look significantly smaller to me than Ferrari. Now, we do know Ferrari can deadlift over 600 pounds because he told us.
Sadly, yes. Mm. Yeah, anyway. No, he doesn't look smaller, but I still believe that, again, we're talking, this is 10 pounds over his Olympic weight he's wrestling, yeah. And 15 pounds over the where he's wrestled at competitively in college in the past. So I do think that some of the weight horsepower had an impact.
Yeah. So Ferrari beats Warner from Iowa, beats Amin. He's in the finals. Bottom side, Cordell Norfleet, who is like Jekyll and Hyde. Sometimes he looks amazing, and then sometimes he doesn't. You know, Bonacorsi beats him. You know, he's coming out of the sixth seed, takes out Norfleet at 3 in a 4-1 match. And then, you know, Eric Schultz from Nebraska falls to North Dakota in the first round, Pence. And then, you know, Pence loses to Beard. And then Woodley beats Beard. And then Bonacorsi, you know, wins the bottom half of the bracket. I mean, kind of crazy. I mean, that is.
Yeah, it was totally blown up. With Bonacorsi and Woodley, I mean, Woodley, like I said, being double-digit, 25th, 26th seed. Again, the PA guy, him and Nino, they're obviously close friends. They commented on that. I just was disappointed that Nino wasn't more offensive in that match, trying to push the pace. I know Ferrari style is definitely challenging for some because he'll go in that low stance, and amazingly, and I'm actually kind of surprised more people aren't able to do what he does, but the way he explodes out of that four-point stance into a double when people kind of charge in on him, it's impressive.
That's a physical freak.
He goes that four-point stance. People come and club over the top, and he just blasts doubles through them. And it seems simplistic in a way that the way he does it, but I guess there's a muscle component to it that makes it not as easy as it looks. You would think more people would do that. It's bizarre.
Yeah, I mean, it's a physical freak, and you know, coming. I mean, that's stalling for 99.9% of the population. For him, it's a setup, and the only
the explosive power he generates from that 4-point stance, and he stays like he's so low to the mat, and all that stuff. You would think even the little guys, the 125s, you would think more people would do that, but maybe they don't have the horsepower behind them to drive and explode out of that position. I think it's something you're going to see people start to emulate, but as much as his online persona tactics annoy me, his talent is impressive. He is good. I think he even annoyed the shit out of his own trainer because he'd run to the corner with his bloody nose and he literally ripped the nose plug out of his hand and like jam it up his own nose and run back to the middle because I'll give him the credit. He wants to keep going, but it's like, the trainer is trying to do his job, clean him up, wipe him down, and he's like ripping the plug out of his hand. He has that villain. He's got that.
He does. He's got the Gable Steveson villain thing going on.
Who's not Oklahoma State?
Yeah, most people disagree with me, but in MMA, in judo, in jiu-jitsu, in boxing, every combat sport, there's no such thing as blood time. I just think that – I think wrestling needs to adopt that. That's my little thing. Now, I have been capping on Iowa quite a bit, but I do want to give out a little bit of a shout-out to Jake Warner. He lost to Ferrari in the quarters, and he wrestled back. He was a 5-seed, and he wrestled back for 4th. I think he's the only Iowa guy to finish above his seed. So I just wanted to give, you know, Jake a little shout out. Cordell Norfleet, the thing that, like, he ended up losing to Nino, and then he just lost in the backside. And he's got a lot of talent. I don't know what the situation is there, but it's one of those things where, you know, sometimes he looks amazing, and then sometimes you just question whether he wants to wrestle. Who else? Mike Beard was 15. He finished 8th. Malvern prep guy, lost to Wyoming. Wyoming has, is that their second All-American, I think? Buchanan. And we already talked a little bit about Woodley. You know, he took 6th, losing to Elam from Missouri. And you know, look, Amin, it's another, you know, I mentioned it earlier with Deacon. You know, you lose as the 1-seed, and he doesn't come mentally apart. And he beats, you know, in sudden victory, he ends up, you know, beating Rocky Elam from Missouri and then ends up beating, you know, Warner. So hats off to him for finishing strong. You know, and that's my take on 97. Any other thoughts?
No, I agree. I was just trying to look it up and I'm not entirely clear on the exact how it worked out, but looking at on track, the seeds, they have a largest seed place differential, and Iowa was minus 8. That was 61 out of 63 teams.
Wow. Wait, what did they finish?
Minus 8 in seed differential.
What's Penn State?
Penn State was plus 14.
Are they the top team?
No, Oklahoma State was plus 39 because of Wyatt Cheeks.
Oh, there you go. Good old Wyatt.
So Oklahoma State, Northwestern at 21, Wisconsin and Rutgers were plus 19, Oklahoma plus 16, Penn State plus 14.
You know, some of those teams, you know, you get the outlier thing. You know, Rutgers had, you know, two guys make runs who weren't seeded, but they were not in national contention. You know, right. when you got a team in contention, I guess that's how you have to wait a little more.
But yeah, Iowa being 61st in the list of minus 8, Nebraska minus 9, Virginia Tech minus 15.
How many teams were there? I thought there was only 62 teams there. And they were 61st?
I'm guessing 63 based upon the
63? All right.
Yeah.
Wow. See, that's the kind of thing when you're a kid who's a recruit or a dad, you're like, that doesn't, you know, they won, but it leaves like a slightly metallic taste in your mouth. All right, let's go up to 285. This is one of the more stacked brackets. You know, Stevenson comes in as one, and Colton Schultz is four, Matt Stenzel's three, and Mason Paris is two. Pretty much everybody has penciled in Stevenson all the way through because he's dominated the two seed at Big Tens just, 2 weeks ago. And what does he have, a fall, a tech, a decision over, Daniel, Greg, Kirkfleet? I don't know if it's Dan or Greg. You know, he beats Kirkfleet 9-4, who's just barely been wrestling this year from injury. And then he beats Tony Cassiope in the semis, 16-6. To get to the finals. And then on the bottom side, things get a little wonky. Stenzel loses to Hilger in a close one. And then Gremmel beats Hilger. Laird runs into Paris and gets majored in Paris. Says fall, tech, major fall on his way to lose 8-4 to Stevenson. Fall, tech, major fall. I mean, this kid is a talent. And as long as Gable Stevenson's there, it's not looking good.
No, I agree. I mean, heavyweight is loaded. Those guys, the fact that you have three former cadet junior world champions placing 1-2-7, and I easily could be excluding some of the others in there because Cassiope has great freestyle cadet, freestyle Greco capabilities. I mean, it's a loaded weight. I was surprised slightly that Gable didn't do more to try to push the pace to get the bonus. I could be wrong, but I believe that both him and Spencer broke their 100% bonus rate in the finals. I think they both had 100% bonus up until the finals, and they both weren't able to do it.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, yeah. A couple things. One, I want to apologize to Iowa because Tony Cassiope also outplaced his seed. I just want to make that clear. He was the fifth seed, finished third. Yeoman's work after losing to Stevenson. I thought Stevenson was going to open it up a little bit. The way he dominated Paris, I think Paris was less wide open, so Gable couldn't score on those re-attacks because Paris wasn't taking those attacks to begin with. And, you know, it was interesting to see what Kirkfleet would have with an extra week of practice. You know, Cassiope, you know, comes back after losing and beats Hilger and, you know, beats Schultz and takes third place, which was, you know, needed points in that tight team race. Gremmel beats Hilger for fifth. Kirkfleet beats Orndorff from Ohio State for seventh. That's another thing. I don't know if anybody had Tate Orndorff as the Ohio State heavyweight earlier in the season. The lineup just kept changing there. And, you know, I would, before this match, I think I told you, like, I would give Stevenson the Hodge. But I felt like he, you know, I don't know if he put an exclamation point on this thing. And I know there's a whole formula for it. But the way he dominated Paris at Big Tens, you know, if he won what would be one of the toughest brackets here at NCAAs, it would be hard to give that Hodge to Spencer Lee.
But I agree. I think the bonus, like I said, they both were 100% prior to finals. But the level of competition at heavyweight, I think, is just so much greater. I mean, how many guys in 125 have
zero
credentials on the national level?
Yeah, zero.
Or world level. I mean, you have three world champions in the heavyweight field.
I thought Paris was.
I thought Paris was. I know it's different. I know the difference. But you got Paris world champ. Kirk world champ.
I thought Paris was a silver medalist. I'm quibbling. Is he a gold medalist?
I thought he won one.
Okay. All right.
Because I thought he pinned the Azeri guy that Tech Wiz.
Okay. You could be right. I'm not sure.
Yeah, but either way, I mean, the fact that you have three guys in a world final. Yeah, Latona's never done that. Camacho's never done that. Brandon Courtney's never done that. Yeah. Any of the guys that were pushing, getting anywhere close to Spencer, none of those have done that. It's just a night and day difference of the level of competition.
Yeah. So I think I would, if I'm not a voter, but I would give, right now I'm giving Gable the Hodge.
You didn't win a Hodge when you were in college? Did you have a vote?
I didn't win. You know, I just didn't win the Hodge. What a pain in the ass. First of all, it wasn't an award when I was in college. That's how old I am, motherfucker.
Hodge is older than you, right?
No, I think the Hodge started in the 90s, right?
No, but Danny Hodge.
Oh, yeah, he's a little bit older than me. He's a little bit older than me. Kick your ass. I would have put this heavyweight as the last match, but the people voted to put Spencer Lee there at 125, and
when I heard RBY was first. I didn't hate it because you had those two big to end it. You had the two big ones. You had Gable and Spencer to end it. So it kind of was a good crescendo in a way.
I agree with you. I do agree with you. Again, I'm a non-traditionalist in that I think wrestling should be like fighting. There should be no order. That by weight, it should just be whatever pair of wrestlers has the highest credentials is last, second highest credentials, second last. And I know it messes everything up, but that way you're building up to your best wrestlers at the end of the match. And that's how, If they go into MMA, that's what's going to happen. If they go into judo or something else, that's how it's going to happen. Anyway, 125, Spencer Lee. Boy, Mr. Both Legs looked like a problem after the finals. He said he was missing an ACL. You know, he tech falled, majored into the finals. Schroeder looked.
My first thought was, okay, Spencer took the knee brace off. Just like 2 years ago where he's like, oh, my God, they freed me. I'm able to take the brace off, and I'm not going to wear one. And so he was out there in two sleeves, traditional knee pad, the long sleeve. And I'm like, oh, maybe it's not so bad. He's just going, you know, he's doing the same thing where he's freeing himself from the brace. And then after the words, he says that he has no ACL. And I'm like, what the hell? I'm like, why did you take the brace off now?
I think he wanted more flexibility. I think people were attacking him. This is the most physical I think we've ever seen Spencer Lee opponents be.
Absolutely. I mean, those majors and the matches that he won leading up to it, he was pushed on his feet more than ever. I mean, he was battling on his feet for these scrambles where they're twisting and turning and cranking on his legs. And then he goes 2-2 into the third period. He gets on top. He gets two sets of tilts, and he wins 10-2.
Yep.
What he did against Schroeder.
Yep.
I was like, oh, so maybe the knee's not as bad, and he's not as hurt as he is. And then he gets off the mat and says he has no ACLs. I'm now starting, is he going to go to Olympic trials?
That's
the biggest question.
That is a big question. He's got the Marinelli, you know, why fix your ACL until you're done competing? And I've talked to him, but I don't know how long ACLs have been gone. I mean, he's had that brace on and off since he's a freshman. And I don't know if it was the Ragusan match at Big Tens that gave – Ragusan was super physical with him. He ended up getting bonus pointed, but, like, all of a sudden people don't go out to wrestle Spencer Lee. Like, they're afraid, and he's still bonusing them late in the third period when – Flo says that he can't score points, but he is, you know, he's a stud. And, you know.
For clarity, Nomad doesn't work for Flo anymore. He's the only one saying that.
Okay. All right. You know, the five seed, Brody Teske, came in. I thought we were going to see him maybe, you know, have a better nationals. I mean, everybody was talking about him. I don't think I saw him wrestle this season, and it was a little bit of a surprise to hear it, but you know, when he ended up losing to Hildenbrandt, who took fourth to McKee, and you know, Teske got pinned by McKee in the backside pretty early on. Where was that?
Biggest thing with 25 was,
say that again.
With my biggest thing with 25 was, you knew Spencer's the one, and then it's kind of a big washing machine of who's left.
Yep.
And I don't know if Brandon Courtney is technically the second best 25 pounder.
Right.
I think he benefited from the being on the bottom side. I'm really surprised Latona was not there, but it was one of those. I mean, Hildenbrandt could have easily been the second best 25 pounder, but he had the misfortune of being on the top side.
Yeah. Well, Jamie, I think if you did this tournament again next week, that and at 125, I think he'd eat, like, this weight class could have the biggest variation of finishes of any of the weight classes. You know, kids who were really tough, whether it's Ragusan or Schroeder, Latona, you know, whether it's the bracket
or Brand, Courtney, yeah, all of them.
Yeah, I think that 125 to me was.
In any way, think that the results are indicative of the who is the actual ranking of who's best, because they went Big Ten champ number one, ACC champ number two, Pac-12 champ number three, MAC champ number four. And there wasn't enough data to differentiate and explain it, to move them around. But I kind of feel like Hildebrandt may have been better than Courtney. Now, Latona didn't show out, and I was disappointed in that, because I was impressed with how he did beating Camacho and the ACCs and all that stuff. But I feel like Hildebrandt got the real short shaft there and is very likely the second best one in the weight and just didn't have a chance to show it.
Yeah. I'm happy that Spencer Lee was able to continue even with his injuries. And, you know, you look at some kids and you're like, oh, no ACL or serious injury, and they're out. And then there's some kids who just keep going. Calling them kids, not right. They're just younger than me. But that takes some serious toughness. You know, crying out loud. I ripped my MCL last winter and I acted like a baby. So, you know, props to finishing strong and being Iowa's lone national champion, and really kind of giving Iowa fans like something to cheer about, because at that point they were 0-2, you know, in the finals, even though they had clinched, and they just needed something to be happy about, you know, to celebrate at the end of the night. So congratulations, high school wrestling, or Pennsylvania wrestling high school kid, Spencer Lee.
Yeah, and I tore my ACL and they put me on some pain meds, and I was able to wrestle the rest of the year without it. So I'm with the Spencer Lee camp that they're not all that important, but at the same time, that's a different level of competition. But yeah, you're right. I mean, Iowa went 1-for-3 in the finals, but they had a much more holistic team, and they brought 10. They scored points from all 10. Now, granted, it was way less than they expected with a lot of those guys. I mean, if I pull up the list of what they did, I mean, they got 25 points from Spencer, 19.5 from DeSanto, 21.5 from Ironman, 2 points from Murin. Caleb Young, 4 points from Marinelli. Number one seed, 4 points.
Can we go back to their number two score for a second? We didn't really talk about him.
Who?
Austin DeSanto.
Yeah, he managed to get third. He had a good tournament. He wrestled well. And then from the online world, it says he kind of went a little ballistic at some point after his third place match, and they decided to pull him from all presentations and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I think he threatened a female NCAA worker, right? Now, I'm sure he wasn't actually threatening her, but he used threatening language. And, you know, I just like, look, when he was doing a Kimura in the finals, when he was, what was that, 2 years ago? Not the finals, but in the NCAA championships. I think he was doing it on the Oklahoma State wrestler when he was at Drexel. Like that's a bridge too far for me. But his outlandish behavior, I dig it. Like, I just think it's a good personality thing. I mean, wrestling is the most intense sport on the planet. Even MMA fighters say, I mean, if they were wrestlers, wrestling was harder. Like, practices are less intense for MMA. The only threat is that no one likes to get knocked out, right, in MMA. But you need people to kind of just have some more personality. And I'm not saying in a bad way, but telling someone to get out of your way or saying something bad to somebody, he suffers his consequences. He's not allowed on the podium, but I'm glad he's part of wrestling.
Yeah, I didn't get any details of what he said or what he did, but it seemed like he had gotten things under control for the last year, and then all of a sudden things have changed in the last here at the end of the week. So it's kind of disappointing. He's a PA boy. I kind of hope he's gonna get his act straight, but who knows? We'll see. We'll get more details as the word gets out afterwards.
All right, Jamie, anything else you want to say about NCAAs?
It was a great tournament. I think despite Penn State getting second, a very strong second, I think it's I think the rest of the world is kind of opened their eyes to the young talent Penn State's got coming.
Yeah. Yeah, and Pennsylvania High School, I don't know if we had the same kind of dominance in the qualifiers we've had in past years. I don't know if you know Zach Funsize Makovsky. He's an MMA fighter, wrestled at Drexel. I'm pretty sure that he did a steady in the 90s where Pennsylvania, one season, had 30% of all NCAA qualifiers. It's mind-boggling. So whatever we had, I think there were 65 or something like that out of 330. So what? That's 20%-ish, roughly. So even though Pennsylvania is like kind of down on the list, like maybe number 7 in actual high school participation in wrestling, the quality is still really good.
Oh, no doubt, no doubt. The quality is not lacking for sure.
Yep. All right, man. Appreciate the time, and I will talk to you soon.
Sounds good. Thank you.